Welcome again. We'll start with our next class that will focus on political science. We'll be starting with class 7, the first chapter that talks about equality. Now, in this class, that's class 7th, we'll be focusing on most of the principles of constitution. So, the first topic that we'll be focusing is the ideas laid down under constitution. Under the constitution, we say each and every citizen of India has equal rights. Now, there is a difference between the theory and the practical that this class tries to focuses on. So, B.R. Ambedkar had said, self-respect is the most vital factor in life. Without it, man is a cipher. Nothing is more disgraceful for a brave man than to live a life devoid of self-respect. So, the whole idea of this session would be focusing on the concept of self-respect. Now, constitution, as we said, guarantees equality to all citizens, but in reality, if we see, there are discrimination based on various reasons. It can be caste, it can be religion, it can be class, or any other reason. Based on that, there are differences in the society that do exist. For example, there are few of those quoted in the book. So, one of the examples is Mr. and Mrs. Ansari go from one place to another looking for a rented house, but they find it very difficult because most of the landlords say that we do not offer the house to a person who consumes non-vegetarian. So, these are kind of some of the things that affect or bring discrimination in the society. So, one of them suggested them to change the name as Mr. and Mrs. Kumar, and they finally refused, saying that this is a question of self-respect. Now, in instances like these, similarly, you have stories about Dalit students being asked to sit aside in the classroom or sit near the door, sweep the school, and so on and so forth. So, these are certain discriminations that definitely exist in the society, and what needs to be worked around is much more on the reality and the ground. So, we can understand that equality and democracy are dynamic concepts. Now, there are three key pillars of democratic government. It involves people's participation, the conflict resolution, and equality. And what we would be focusing on today is equality, which is one of the key factors of democratic government. Now, under democratic government, we also say we have the universal adult franchise, that's the right to vote for each and every individual, and this right to vote is based on equality. But when we say we have the right to vote and that is based on equality, why not there are other factors where we say each and every person has an equal stance? So, right to vote is there, but what about right to equal living? So, there is no kind of equality in terms of living standards. There are huge disparities that need to be worked around. Equal working conditions. So, a worker who is working as a domestic helper or a sweeper is not given equal working conditions as a person who is working on a kind of sophisticated technology or a kind of professional technology. Similarly happens with caste identity. Now, this caste identity not only exists in the minds of uneducated people, but also in the educated and urban minds. So, this is something that needs to be worked around. Then you have the situation of Dalits. As we said, they are asked to sit aside, they are asked to sweep the rooms. So, all this is a kind of feeling that brings in disrespect or affects the self-respect of an individual. So, all this needs to be worked around. Om Prakash Valmiki, who himself was a Dalit, wrote a biography, Jothan, where he talked about his experiences as growing up as a Dalit boy. So, these are some of the stories that bring in the real, the reality or the ground state of the equality when we talk about. So, the key idea is, one must recognize the dignity of an individual. So, unequal treatment violates the dignity. Self-respect should not be challenged. So, these are the key ideas that we must work around. So, this chapter per se is less about theory and more about what happens in the practical life. And as a student, you should not grow up with these things in mind. So, equality is provided in the demography. So, when we say equality, as per the demography or as per the democracy, as per the constitution, I would say, every individual including male and female, so either gender, from all caste, religion, tribe, educational or economic status are given equal rights or equality. So that is what is laid down in the constitution. And if we really want to abide by the constitution, we must recognize the equality in the democratic setup. So there are four key things that that must be worked around in the society. First is, every person is equal before law. Untouchability of any form should be abolished. There should be no discrimination based on race, caste, creed, gender or religion. And every person must have access to all public places, be it roads, be it water supplies, be it wells or any other thing. So discriminating that these roads are meant only for privileged few would not work. So there should be kind of equality for all these amenities and all these services that are present in the society. Now when we talk about the implementation of equality, this implementation occurs by various forms. So you have the implementation by the means of laws. So there are various laws that explain the kind of equality that should be maintained in the society. On the other hand, you have many of the programs that are being launched by the government to help or to focus on the disadvantaged group, the underprivileged group or the underprivileged section of the society. It helps to provide greater opportunity to grow. So there are some of the schemes. For example, midday meals is a common scheme. Now midday meals scheme was started by the government, and this was in lieu of the government schools, where they tried to provide cooked food or cooked meal to the candidates who are coming into the school or the students who are coming into the school. Why this scheme was started? Let's look into that. This scheme was started to increase the enrollment ratio in this school. Again, there was an idea that after lunch, most of the students did not turn up back to the school. So if you provide food to them in the school premises itself, the retention for the school hours would prolong, and after the lunch hours also you would see students who would be there in the campus. Again, the idea was the working mothers have to spare time for the lunch and then join back to the work, which becomes difficult for them sometimes because most of them are employed in a kind of daily wages job. So most of the students opting for government schools have the parents have a cycle or a routine curriculum which is much more difficult, where taking breaks is much more difficult. This also intends to reduce any kind of caste prejudice and provide more employment to the people, because one, there would be people who would be cooking the meals and providing it. So there is more kind of employment opportunities with the school. So these were some of the ideas based on that this midday scheme was started. Again, the problem of malnutrition, hunger could be resolved if proper meals are provided to the students. However, this scheme suffered certain drawbacks, and recently there are propositions that midday meals should be abolished. However, it is yet to be implemented. So there are various schemes like this. So you have the Antyodaya Ann Yojana, the food for the poorest of the poor, helping through the public distribution system. So there are many schemes that are meant for uplifting the disadvantaged or the underprivileged section of the society. The key idea here is, as a government, the government would definitely provide in schemes, provide in laws for equal implementation. But who is going to do that? It's ultimately on us or the people. So what is the main idea here is to change an attitude of an individual. This change obviously is a slow and gradual change. Slowly and gradually, people do not ask for your caste, for your surnames, and ultimately each one who is coming onto the school is given an equal platform. So there is a kind of change. However, this is a continuous struggle that needs to be worked on, and this equality should not only be in the books but should be seen on the real ground. Now, there have been instances of inequality at a worldwide level. If we go on to South Africa, you have Nelson Mandela, who fought for the rights of the blacks. Similarly, if you go on to United States, you have the African Americans who were brought from Africa as slaves are treated as a second person. So in the buses, if you see, they are not given seats. And these are some of the common problems that they used to face during the period. before the civil rights movement started in the United States, and it was mainly with the idea of Rosa Parker, who was one of the leading idea behind the civil rights movements in the United States. She refused to give a seat to a white person in the bus while traveling after a whole day work. So that was the basic cause when the civil rights movement started. And finally, you had the Civil Rights Act, which started in 1964. Definitely, there has been worldwide change in the attitude of the people. However, there are certain challenges ahead. The first key challenge is the struggle for recognition that all persons are equal, be it from different country, be it from a different caste, be it from a different religion. And finally, the struggle for their dignity should be that their dignity should be maintained, or the idea of self-respect. So these are the two main challenges ahead. If these are resolved, definitely there would be a kind of equality at par that could be seen in the society. So as we said, this chapter is more about creating awareness in the society and a kind of bringing in a practical approach, helping you to think more on the issues rather than a kind of theoretical topic. So with this, we start the political science series for class 7th. We'll be coming up with more lectures in the upcoming classes. Have a good day ahead.